Hello, myself Mr. Sunil Devkar, Assistant Professor in Department of English of Rao Bahadur Narayan Rao Boroke College, Srirampur. Today, I am going to speak on the topic, a poem by John Keats on the grasshopper and the cricket. John Keats was a romantic poet. The romantic period, it lasted from 1798 to 1830. William Wordsworth was the representative poet of this age. Return to nature, or nature was the main theme of this period. It was revolt against classicism. There was impact of French Revolution, liberty, equality and fraternity on the period of on the romantic period. So William Wordsworth, the major themes of romantic period, they were simplicity, return to nature, supernatural element, worship of nature, and the rural or the rustic life of the peasants. Wordsworth defined poetry as a spontaneous overflow of powerful feelings recollected in tranquility. He wrote famous poems, Daffodils, Solitary Reaper. In these lyrical poems, he has, in a very beautiful manner, he has described nature. He has described nature, yon solitary highland lash, lonely singing, cutting and binding the grains. So the song of the Scotland hills, in that the lady is singing by herself. So the nature, or the natural themes of the nature, they are being expressed. He and S.T. Coleridge, along with his sister Dorothy Wordsworth, they worked together. So he composed first his lyrical ballads in the year 1800. And so major, that they worked together. They worked together. Even S.T. Coleridge, he worked on the poem Rhyme of the Ancient Mariner. So all these poems together, they contribute to this romantic movement. John Keats was also one of the well-known poem of the second generation. William Blake was also one of the poet, a renowned poet of this generation, and even I would say P.B. Shelley. P.B. Shelley was also one of them. So John Keats, he focused on the two types of, that means he wrote two collections, Songs of Innocence and Song of Experience. In Song of Innocence, he expressed the natural nature of human being, a child. In his collection, we can give the best example of that poem, The Lamb. The lamb is a symbol of innocence, and the other side, the tiger, is the symbol of experience. So this that means he dealt with innocence and reality in his collection of poems. So John Keats, naturally, he lived for only 25 years. He lived for only 25 years, and in this period, naturally, he focused on nature, or you can say his poems or the quotes which are been mentioned. Beauty is truth and truth is beauty. A thing of beauty is joy forever, are the major quotes which he has mentioned. And even in this poem, on the grasshopper and the cricket, the famous quote, the poetry of earth is never dead. So all this you can say, that nature is at the center. Nature is at the center. Both sides of nature, they are reflected in his poetry. Heard melodies are more sweeter than the unheard melodies. A thing of beauty, joy forever. So these are the major, you can say, the major major quotes of John Keats. So his poetic career, it lasted for only 4 years. His well-known poems, they are Ode to Autumn, On First Looking into Chapman's Homer, Ode to Gracian Urn, La Belle Dame Sans Merci. So here you can say the other poem, Ode to Autumn. He is also known for his classical constructions of the poetical construction, the classical poetical construction. So here in his poem, Ode to Autumn, the poem is constructed into three stanzas. Each stanza, it has 11 lines in Ode to Autumn. So the first, in the first stanza, naturally the autumn season, it is the season of peace and mellow fruitfulness. The sun is at the center. All the crops or the fruits, they are ripe. And the role of the maturing sun, it plays a very significant role, which has been mentioned in the first stanza. Then in the second stanza, autumn in action, that means reaping of the crops. Reaping of the crops, that means autumn is personified into the shape of woman in the second stanza. And everyone is busy. Everyone is busy in the harvest. And the harvest is done in the second stanza. And in the final stanza, the post scenario after the harvest, that means it is the dying, it is the dying year, it is the setting year, and there he owned the philosophy of life. It has been expressed. The rising sun, it signifies birth, and the setting sun, it signifies death. And after that means one who comes to birth has to die. So naturally, we know John Keats, he died of tuberculosis. He died of tuberculosis, and he knew that he was going to die, and he has accepted death through this poem, Ode to Autumn. So even his another poem, La Belle Dame Sans Merci, in that also, it's a ballad, and so in that poem also, we could see the knight at arms, and how he's been deceived by the witch, or by that fairy witch, and how he narrates the story. So all we can say, the description is natural, or the supernatural element, it plays a significant role in La Belle Dame Sans Merci. In this poem, on the grasshopper and the cricket, if you see, the poem is written in a sonnet form. We know there are two types of sonnet, English sonnet and Italian sonnet. The English sonnet construction, where it is three quatrains followed by a couplet with rhyming scheme ABAB, CDCD, EFEF, GG. And the Italian sonnet, the rhyming scheme of Italian sonnet is ABBA, ABBA, CDC, CDC, or CDE, CDE. So that is the rhyming scheme of Italian sonnet. So here, in a sense, the Italian sonnet, the development of the thought or the physical description, the problem, it has been aroused in the octave, in the first eight lines. It has been aroused in the first eight lines, and the solution or the introspection, it is the second, it is in the sestet of the poem. So here, this is an Italian form of sonnet, which on the grasshopper and the cricket. So the octave with eight lines and the sestet with six lines. So in the octave, naturally, in this poem, he has described nature. The two seasons, they have been mentioned. The title itself, it is significant. On the grasshopper and the cricket, these two insects, one is grasshopper. For grasshopper in Marathi, we call as Naktoda. And for cricket in Marathi, we call as Ratkida. So these two insects, what is the role of these two insects in these two seasons? It has been clearly mentioned in this poem. So I will turn to the first octave of the poem. So you can see the first line itself is a quote of John Keats, the famous quote of John Keats. The poetry of earth is never dead. So just see the theme of the poem itself, it is reflected in the first line. The poetry of the earth is never dead. So what does it mean? The poetry means what? Music. What is the music of earth? Earth has natural music. You can say the twittering of the birds, the blowing of the winds, rising of the tides in the sea, or the blowing, that means the sounds of the water, all these, they contribute to the poetry of nature. And that's why poet says the poetry of the earth never dies. It never dies, it never ceases, you can say. The poetry of earth is never dead. Never dead, it is always immortal. And the music, it will continue. It will continue throughout. It will not stop. And that is the theme of the poem, which he has expressed his thought through this poem. And these two insects, they play an important role. So the first insect which has been mentioned, it is grasshopper. When all the birds are faint with hot sun, I'll just read first of all the octave. The earth, the poetry of earth is never dead. When all the birds are faint with hot sun and hide in cooling trees, a voice will run from hedge to hedge about the new mown mead, that is the grasshoppers. He takes the lead in summer luxury he has never done. With his delights, for when tired out with fun, he rests at ease beneath some pleasant weed. So here, what does he want to say? As the grasshopper, he contributes the theme of the poem. In the extreme heat of the sun, the quality of the sun has been mentioned here. What is the quality of the sun? The sun gives heat, or the hot sun. Hot sun, morning sunlight is different. Afternoon sunlight is different. And evening, the sunlight, the temperature, it varies. It might be pleasant, it might be hot, or it might be moderate, you can say. So here you can say, likewise, in extreme hot, when no one is ready to stand in the extreme hot sun, at that time, who comes out or who comes forth? It is the grasshopper. It is the grasshopper who takes the stage, or he starts singing. So he starts singing, or who contribute to the music of the nature, to the music of the nature. And what is the music of the nature? It is the voice of the grasshopper, which has been mentioned here. Voice will run. That means whose voice it is? It is the voice of the grasshopper. When all the birds are faint. Faint means what? When, due to hot sunlight, all these birds, they have returned to their nest. Even the human beings, in extreme hot, we return to our houses or abode. At that time, everyone is in their cozy places, or the birds, they are in the cooling trees. Cooling trees means in the shady places. They are in the safe zone, and they hide themselves in the cooling trees. And at that time, who takes over? It is the voice of the cricket. Where from hedge to hedge. Hedge means what? H-E-D-G-E, hedge. From hedge to hedge means the planted trees in row or in a line, it is called as hedge. So from there it will take place, from hedge to hedge, about the new mown mead. The new mown mead means grassy land which is newly cut. So in that, from that grassy land, so from there the voice of the grasshopper, it will be heard, or we can hear the song of the grasshopper. That is grasshopper, he takes the lead in summer luxury. In summer luxury. So here he can say the adverse situation. What is the condition? It is the adverse situation, that is, it is extreme hot, but he loves to sing in that summer luxury. So that's why the word luxury, it is used in what? In adverse condition also, it expresses the happiness. It expresses the happiness in singing. That grasshopper, he gets happiness, and that's why the word luxury is explained in a different manner here. So the summer luxury, that means it gets pleasure. It gets pleasure even in that hot sun. He has never done. So he has never done means what? He has never stopped. When it is extreme hot, he will start singing. He can say, with his delights. Delights means pleasure. With happiness. So he doesn't feel that the external atmosphere is hot. He does not bother. He does not pay attention to it. He pays attention on what? He pays attention on his singing. So he pays attention on his singing. Delights. For when tried out with fun. So he takes, he can say it is fun. It is a joy for him. He rests at ease. He rest at ease means he stay there on the grass at ease beneath some pleasant weed. So beneath some pleasant weed he will stay there and he will continue singing. So he'll continue singing with fun, with delight, with luxury. These words we have been used. At one side it is hot, but then also his attitude is what? That means his attitude is entertainment, of joy, fun, luxury. He gets from that hot sun, which has been expressed in the first octave of this sonnet in a very perfectly manner. The first season which has been mentioned, it is the summer season. It is taken over by the grasshopper, and the song of the grasshopper we can clearly see in the first 8 lines. Now I will turn to the sestet. In the sestet, the poet, he focuses on what? He focuses on the another insect. Who is the another insect? The another insect here which has been mentioned, it is cricket. And here he says grasshopper's voice, and here he says cricket's song. So who is contributing here in the second stanza? The second stanza, the contribution, it is of the cricket. It is of the cricket. And the, in a similar manner, the first line of the poem, it started with the poetry of earth is never dead. Here also in a similar manner, the poetry of earth is ceasing never. The poetry of earth is ceasing never. On a lone winter, on a lone winter. Lone winter means what? Lone means isolated. No one dares to come out. No one dares to come out. So we know in European countries, as compared to India, the temperature, it is in minus, or you can say if you go to north side, Jammu Kashmir, there we see Leh Ladakh, the temperature is below 10, 20 degrees centigrade. So in this extreme winter season, who will come out of their houses? Who will come out of their houses? Everyone is in their houses with some room heater, or in the close cozy places in the bed, or next to fire. So at that time, again, who comes forward? It is the cricket who takes over. It is the cricket who takes over in the winter season. So just I'll read the sestet. You can clearly understand. The poem is written in a very simple style. So the poetry of earth is ceasing never. On a lone winter evening, when the frost has wrought, that means brought in, wrought means brought in, a silence from the stove, there shrills the cricket song in warmth increasing ever, and seems to one in drowsiness half lost, the grasshoppers among some grassy hills. So here you see, as I have told you, the poetry of earth is never ceasing. And here he says, on a lone winter evening. So here, which season it has been mentioned? Winter evening. And here, it is the summer. So here, as I have told you, here which is the season which has been mentioned? It is the winter season. And here it was mentioned, the summer season. On a lone winter evening. That means this is also the adverse condition for the insects, birds, or human beings in extreme cold. When the frost means snowfall. When there is heavy snowfall, the temperature is below 0 degrees centigrade at that time. So everyone, you can say, there is brought in silence. There is silence everywhere. There is silence. No one will come out from the stove. And then what happens? From the stove. Stove means what? In the kitchen, by the side of the fire or the stove or the gas, we may say, there in the kitchen we see, in a house which is the warmest place. The warmest place is kitchen, because the fire, it might be burning, or hearth, it might be burning there. So next to that stove, who is there? There is a cricket. The cricket in some corner of that kitchen, we see it shrills. Shrills means what? Makes sound or sing. Shrill, shrills, shrills. That means it makes sound. So it makes sound or it sings. And the singing of that cricket, it is an entertainment. It is an entertainment to whom? To the listeners. It is an entertainment to the listeners. And that's why the cricket song, in warmth increasing. Warmth means what? the temperature naturally after singing or listening any musical concern or a dance program or any cultural program, we get pleasure, you are pleased, or you can say we are lost. Lost in what sense? We are with the speaker or the singer, or we get, that means the cool atmosphere or the temperature, it rises. Warmth means what? There is a solace with the singing of whom? With the singing of this cricket insect, you can say. The cricket song in warmth increasing, the temperature it naturally decreases. Of whom? Of the listeners. Like a lullaby who is not sleeping, a lullaby is been sung. So in a similar manner, here also the song of the cricket, it is a lullaby. To whom? To the listeners, it increases the warmth, and everyone is happy to listen the song of the cricket. So the cricket song in warmth increasing ever, and seems to one in drowsiness. Drowsiness means what? There is the drowsiness, in Marathi we call it as nasha. Ha nasha kasha sam that ekani. So this drowsiness, it is all of what? It is due to the song. It is the natural drowsiness due to the song of the cricket. Drowsiness, half lost, you can say. The grasshopper among some grassy hills. Again, that means in the last line, again the grasshopper among some grassy hills. So we could see there is a parallel symmetry in these two stanzas, in the octave and the sestet. These two insects, they contribute to what? The adverse situation. In the adverse situation also, they go on singing and they contribute to the song of the nature. As he says, the poetry of the earth is never dead, or the poetry of earth is ceasing never. So the repetition of the first line of both stanzas, only the final word it has been changed, ceasing never, and here the poetry of earth is never dead. Dead and ceasing, these words, they have been changed, and there is the repetition of the same line. So, and overall, that it expresses the stress on that line, it indicates about the theme of the poem. It indicates about the theme of the poem. So now I'll turn, this is all about the poem. Now I'll turn to the other elements of the poetry. What are the major themes which are being expressed in this poem? Nature. First theme is nature. Nature, it plays a very significant role in human life and in everyone. All we are part and parcel of nature. So if we say, what is nature? All these living things, they might be animals, insects, birds, whosoever they might be, they are the part and parcel of this nature. The sun, the rocks, the hills, the grass, all these are the part and parcel of nature. And so nature, it plays a very significant part. So what is a thing of joy is forever, when he says. So nature, the beauty of nature, we should try to understand. So nature is what? The two sides of the nature, they have been shown. So first, the physical quality of nature. When we describe nature, how is the nature described in the poem? If you see the different elements which are being described in the poem, they are the, that means the sun, the trees, the maid, all these you can say. Here you may say the grasshopper, the cricket, winter, all these you can say, they are the part and parcel of nature. And at the other side, the qualities, when we say nature, physical description, and at the other side, qualities of nature. What are the qualities of nature? The sun is hot. The sun is hot. The winter is cold. The cricket and the grasshopper, they are singing. The colors of the nature, all these you can say the qualities of nature. The qualities of nature, they have been expressed in a very proper manner. So that is the first theme of the poem. Then next, second theme, it deals with the seasons. There are two seasons mentioned in this poem. One is winter season and another is summer season. And what is the role of winter season and what is the role of summer season? And in these two seasons, what is the role of these two insects, grasshopper and the cricket? It is clearly reflected. And the human nature, or the animals and the birds, how do they react at that event or at that moment? It is clearly expressed. Third theme is of hope. Hope, there is hope. Yes, day alters night. So even he can say here, the theme in a sense, after sorrow, that is happiness. So here also, even in this adverse situation, these two insects, grasshopper and cricket, they are the symbol of hope. They are the symbol of hope. One should never give up. One should never give up. You should stand even in adverse situation. That is the third theme which has been expressed in the poem. Next is tenacity. Tenacity in Marathi we may call it as chivatpana. Chivatpana konacha? Grasshopper and cricket. The theme of tenacity. They never give up. Who? The grasshopper and the cricket. Yes. That means they know their role. They know their role as, that means they have to sing the poetry of earth. They are the part and parcel of nature, and their role they fulfill in a very clear manner, which has been expressed there. And lastly, he speaks of beauty. So beauty of nature. What is the beauty? Beauty is both, he can sing. Beauty is sweet or fruitful at one side, and at the other side, the beauty is also harsh. Beauty is also harsh. That means nature, the way in which you look to nature, nature will reward you. William Wordsworth, he has rightly said, if you worship nature, nature will give you wholeheartedly. If you go against nature, nature will punish you. So the same theme we can say related to beauty. So yes, beauty is beautiful, but at the same time, it is also harsh. The two sides of nature, they are clearly reflected through the beauty of nature. Then others, there are the rhyming words which are being used in the poem. They contribute to the poem. So overall, we may say John Keats, he has perfectly blended the poem with these two insects, explaining the seasons in a very clear-cut manner. So this much explanation, it would be enough for you. Thank you for listening me. Thank you.